Give me what to say. Let me hear you clearly define what I am to do. Let every word penetrate the heart. Let what is said lead them running to your arm. Use me, Lord. Use me, Lord.
The book of Luke, chapter 18, and verse number 1. Luke 18 and 1. And the word of the Lord declares, and he spake a parable unto them to this end, that men ought always to pray and not to faint. Always to pray and not to faint. And the next verse that our next book that we'll look at is the book of Ephesians. Chapter number 6 and verse 18, praying always with all prayer and supplication in the Spirit, and watching thereunto with all perseverance and supplication for all saints. Perseverance. If I had a topic today, I want to talk about perseverance in prayer, persistency in prayer, being persistent in prayer, perseverance in prayer. I used the 18th verse of Ephesians, the book of Ephesians, the last time that I had an opportunity to minister before you, and it was something particular about specifically verse number 18 and chapter 6 of Ephesians and Luke, and both of these are connected. It talks about always to pray and praying always. And during my prayer time and during my meditation, I was asking the Lord, I just was praying about a word, about an encouraging and a strengthening word for God's people, to encourage them during prayer. We've been doing intercessory prayer for the last 3 months, every Thursday. If you're not doing anything tomorrow at 7 o'clock, we have intercessory prayer. When I say that, the Lord has been meeting us there. He has been meeting us there. One of the things about Ephesians chapter 6 and verse 18, we know that that specific chapter, on that specific verses above that, it talks about the armor of God. And Paul talks about the equipment that we need to fight spiritual warfare and all of the things that are necessary when it comes to do battle against the enemy. Amen? And so he goes down the line, but in verse number 10 of that chapter, it says, finally, my brethren, be strong in the Lord and in the power of his might. And Paul goes on to describe all of the necessities in war gear that you need for spiritual warfare. He goes into the breastplate, and he talks about the helmet of salvation and the gospel and the belt and all of the different weapons and the shield of faith. The most interesting thing that I found when I was reading or studying this was that after you receive all of the weapons of warfare, after you've been given, he says, above all, take the shield of faith. Above everything you do, take the shield of faith. And then he goes on to say, take the sword of the Spirit, the sword of the Spirit, the word of God. But the next words after that, he says, praying always, as soon as he talks about the word of God, he immediately goes into praying always. It's impossible to fight battles and spiritual battles without fighting always. And there's a connection. Those three things is faith and the word of God and praying always. Those three things are a remedy, are a weapon against our enemy. The word of God, the shield of faith, because none of any of this works unless you have faith. And unless you have faith and unless you have God's word, unless you're praying and believing in God's promises. That really caught my eye. I was like, wow, the way that it connected. And I want to talk a little bit about perseverance in prayer. See, there should never be a time that we, as God's people, neglect or pass opportunities to pray. We're living in a day and time where we should be praying every single day on a regular basis all day. Lord God, help us. Help us, God, protect us and protect our families from dangers that are seen and unseen. There's so many people that are loose cannons and people that are doing things, violence, that is so unexpected. And you have to ask God to protect and shield your family. When you look at Romans chapter 12, Romans 12 and verse number 12. And it reads, rejoicing in hope. Patient in tribulation, continuing instant in prayer. Instant in prayer, steadfastly or earnest towards prayer. That means that at any moment or any time, we should have the ability to go before God in prayer. Amen. We must always maintain a spirit of prayer and never grow weary, though our prayers sometimes appear to be in vain. When you look at Luke and Luke chapter 18 and 1, it says, always pray. And even Ephesians, it says, praying always, at all times, frequently, on occasions, without fainting, becoming feeble or weakened under trials. When you look at the word fainting, I love looking at the Greek and the Hebrew interpretation of the specific words that are in the Bible, because it really gives you a true understanding and a definition of what fainting is, what being weary is, and what persevering is, and what fainting is. Fainting is not when someone passes out from a lack of energy. The fainting they're speaking about talks about when an individual becomes feeble or timid or fearful under trials. That is the fainting that the word is really describing when we look at what Jesus said when he said men always ought to pray and not to faint, not become feeble, don't become timid or afraid of your enemies. It happens more times than we would like to admit, but oftentimes during prayer or when we are earnestly seeking the Lord, if we feel unconnected or we have this feeling that God is not answering our prayer, God is not responding to us in a timely manner, or he's not answering or meeting the need that we're seeking him for, or it does not meet the personal expectations, we so easily just give up because it's not what we expected from God. Oftentimes, we want God to answer immediately, and God does not work on our time. God works on his time, and God responds when he wants to respond. We can pray and pray and pray, but Jesus, when we're looking at this parable in Luke in 18 and 1, he's trying to make a point. And that point is that don't get weary in prayer. Don't give up. Don't let your faith take a hit when God does not respond in the way that you need him to respond. I feel it in here. I'm getting warmed up a little bit here. See, obstacles come in the way of effective and constant prayer. Jesus knew that we need to be taught and encouraged always to pray. Why is it so easy to not pray and so easy to quit? It's not persevering when you just give up just like that. You're not really trying to push and to move God's heart and his hand on your behalf. It's easy to lose heart in prayer because we're not always convinced of the reality of the power of prayer. Too often, prayer becomes a last resort instead of the first resource. Many times, can I say that again? Prayer to many people becomes a last resort instead of a first resource. Instead of going to God first, instead of petitioning and asking and bringing your concerns to God immediately, we'll put God on the back burner and expect him to act immediately on our behalf. Instead of making him the immediate source of what we need. The parable in Luke in 18 and 1 that Christ uses teaches us that no matter how long it takes, or even if it appears that God is not hearing your prayer, you don't grow weary, you don't get tired, you have to persevere, you have to push forward. In 2 Samuel 22 and 7, 2 Samuel 22 and 7, David said, in my distress, hallelujah, praise the living God. He said, I called upon the Lord and cried to my God, and he did hear my voice out of his temple, and my cry did enter into his ears. So don't think for one second that when you're praying and when you're asking God for something that God does not hear. The eyes of the Lord roam to and from all over the earth to watch over his people. He's omnipresent. He's all powerful. He's all knowing. There isn't nothing that we can tell God that he doesn't already know. See, when Christ is speaking in Luke 18 and 1, he's describing to us in the parable a widow who obtained what she wanted from an unjust and a cruel judge. When you do the background study of it, when you look at what Jesus is talking about, it was not a Hebrew judge, because the Hebrews or the Jews used elders to settle disputes amongst brothers and sisters. We believe that this was a Roman magistrate who had a very foul way of dealing with people. But see, the woman, she did not cease. She never stopped coming to him asking for justice. And the parable is trying to let us know that if an unjust judge, someone, this man, he didn't even regard man, nor did he regard God. He could have cared less about what God or man was talking about. But the God that we have, our Savior, our Deliverer, our strength, if a person that is unjust would do justice to a woman, just think what our God will do to us if we stay persistent and we stay on our knees and on our face praying to him. God's purpose, Christ's purpose in this parable is just to encourage us. And I'm here to encourage you tonight. Do not lose your heart, do not lose your strength. Always to pray. Always look for God to send an answer. Oftentimes during when we pray, we often pray during distress. We often pray during when we need something. We often ask God, God, I need you to show up for this job, and I need you to show up for this surgery. I need you to deliver my son or my daughter from drugs or prostitution. But how many times, or when was the last time? When was the last time, praise the living God, that you stepped outside, and when you got down on your knees and you prayed outside of your afflictions? When was the last time that you prayed outside of your heartache, outside of your personal and issues and needs that you have? When was the last time that you got on your knees and said, Lord, I don't need anything but to thank you for who you are in my life? Sometimes, saints of God, brothers and sisters, we got to get on our knees and just say, Lord, thank you. Lord, thank you. I might not have a mansion, but I got a roof over my head. Lord, I might not have a Bentley, dear God, but I got transportation. My God, I might not be an executive, dear God, but I thank you, God, that I got a job. Father, I thank you, dear God, that I have car insurance. Lord, I thank you that when I go to the hospital, I can just give them my card and be admitted without an issue. When was the last time? Can I preach right in this part? I feel like preaching now. I feel like lifting him up. When was the last time that you got on your knees and said, Lord, I don't need anything. Lord, I just came here to praise and thank you for all that you've done. Lord, I thank you for waking me up in the morning. Lord, I thank you for being my protection throughout the night. Father, when people were getting shot down the street, when the accident occurred when I was driving down the street, my God, you were protecting me from the accidents. Father, you protected me from dangers, dear God, seen and unseen. My God, you've kept my son, dear God, off of drugs. You've kept my daughter, dear God, off the streets. My God, I only come right now to give you the praise. When was the last time that you just got on your knees and said, Lord, I magnify you? When was the last time you just got on your knees and said, Lord, I give you the glory? When was the last time you got on your knees and just said, Lord, I don't need to do anything but to praise your name? When was the last time, God, you just got on your knees and said, Lord, thank you for delivering me. Thank you for being my healer. Lord, I don't want anything. Thank you for your long suffering. Lord, I'm a sinner saved by grace, and all I want to do is say thank you, God. Thank you. Sometimes we got to get on our knees in the midst of everything that's taking place, and we just got to say thank you. Sometimes we got to get on our knees and we just got to give God the glory. It's not always about asking God for something. It's not always about saying, God, I have a specific need. Can I preach like I feel it? Is it not always about asking God, God, I need a new car or a new job? Lord God, I thank you for a mind to serve you. I thank you for the ability, dear God, to even get on my knees, God. I thank you, dear God, the ability to be able to praise you. Lord God, I thank you, dear God, for your this life, your strength, your peace, and your joy. See, prayer is not to weary us, but it's to exercise us. It helps us to fight against impatience, and it teaches us not to yield to the afflictions and the adversaries. It's telling us, it teaches us not to lose heart. My brothers and sisters, I'm appealing to you today. Persevere in prayer. Don't lose heart. Don't back up on the enemy. Don't give up and don't give in. When we look at the book of James, in James verse number 16, that's James chapter 5 and verse number 16. And it goes on to say, it says, confess your faults one to another and pray for one another that ye may be healed. But I want to focus on the latter clause of this particular verse. specifically the effectual fervent prayer of a righteous man availeth much. The effectual fervent prayer of a righteous man availeth much. When you look at what effectual really means, when you go into these words and you get an understanding of what an effectual prayer is, it's not somebody that's praying all loud, amen, praise the living God, that can shout all loud and just screaming at the top of their voice. When you talk about effectual prayer, the meaning is very strong. It's energizing. It's the prayer of a righteous man availeth much. It's an energizing prayer. When you look at what fervent really means, when you get an understanding about what it means to be fervent for God, have you ever really taken the time to take a look at that word? Well, guess what? I'm going to tell you what it means tonight. Fervent means to be hot. The Bible or the Hebrew, the Greek, describing as prayer that's so hot that it's hot enough to boil liquids, or it's hot enough to make metal to glow. It's an earnest prayer that's a prayer without ceasing. It's a fiery petition to God. When was the last time that you went into your prayer closet? When was the last time that you went into your prayer room and you just set the room on fire with God's power, with His Holy Spirit? When was the last time that you prayed that you just felt the anointing? You felt the power and strength of God. You felt the very fire of God. That's what fervent prayer is. It's the very fire. It's the very power of God. When you're praying fervently, you're contending against the adversary. You're going up against the devil with everything that you have. Don't you know that the enemy wants to keep you from praying? Have you ever noticed that when you decide to take the time out to begin to pray, when you decide to take the time out, all of a sudden folks want to start calling you in, and people want to start texting you in. It's something good that's coming on TV. Man, that's the adversary. That is the enemy. He will do anything that he possibly can to distract you from God's word. Effectual. The Greek word for effectual means that is an energetic prayer that just has power. It's a prayer of power. It's getting down on your knees, getting in your prayer room, getting in your prayer closet, and praying to God with power, praying to God with strength, and saying, Lord, in the name of Jesus, my God, I bind every adversary. I'm coming against the enemy, God, with strength and with power. It's not some lazy prayer. It's not some formal thing. It's a prayer of power. See, when you study this passage or verse in the book of James, James is talking about an individual that is not a hypocrite, because it's impossible. You can't live a worldly lifestyle and have a prayer life. It's impossible to do. Prayer is not just a 1 or 2 day thing. When we have intercessory prayer in the morning and in the afternoon, I'm praying, I'm asking, I'm begging God, God, tell us what to say. Lord, I'm asking God, Lord, show up. And even after intercessory prayer, before I go to bed at night, I say, Lord, I thank you. My God, cover my family, because guess what? The enemy don't want you to pray. And when he sees you praying, he's going to throw any and every single thing that he can throw at you. See, this is not a prayer. The effectual person is not a prayer of a non-righteous man. It's a righteous man or a righteous woman who has been justified by the righteousness of Christ and has the truth of God's grace in him. See, that man or woman lives humbly. They live soberly. They live sincerely. They believe and they trust in God. You can't get on your knees talking about I believe and I trust in God and not have any faith. What is the time? You're wasting your time. You got to have faith, and your lifestyle has to equate to what your prayer is. That means that you just can't be living any kind of willy kind of way. Any willy and nilly. My wife says that word, willy-nilly, any kind of way. living and doing any and everything that you're big enough to do. But then you want God to answer on your behalf as soon as you get in trouble. Oh, it does not work like that. See, this person is a person that's living humbly. They're sober. They have belief and trust in God's holy word. See, fervent prayer has power and energy, and it causes God to move on your behalf. It causes God, it moves God's heart. When you look at the word of God, you see in Samuel, David, when he prayed, God answered him. God stood up off of his throne. And the Bible said that he rode on the wings of the wind and on the back of a cherub. My God, they said that fire came out of his nostrils. My God, when he touched the earth trembled. When you got a real relationship with God, when you got a real relationship, a real love and heart for God, God is going to get up off his throne and he's going to come and answer every prayer that you want, that you have. A person that is persevering and fervently praying is praying out of their spirit and with a true heart and with faith. They have genuine love for God's people when they pray. See, it's not always about you, about me when we pray. See, sometimes you have to pray and you ask God to meet the needs of others. That's called intercession. That's when we're standing in the gap for those who don't have the ability to pray like you do. You're standing in the gap from a person that might be unsaved. See, effective prayer must be fervent, not because we must emotionally persuade a reluctant God. God doesn't have the answer, but we must gain God's heart by being fervent for the things he is fervent for. See, we got to have fire for the things that God has fires for. You got to have fire for souls. I remember, I'm going to tell a brief story. I remember while I was doing outreach some years ago, and one of my best friends, I love him to death. We were soldiers on the battlefield in outreach. And I remember we would always pray, Lord, send us some people, because at the time, it was maybe two or three of us. And we were out there. It didn't matter, cold. It was me, him, one of our other brothers. Someone made the sandwiches and the tracks. His wife helped us, and we would always say, Lord, send people. Send people to help witness to these souls. Lord, send people to help touch God's people. And guess what? That ministry grew to where it just exploded with people. We touched so many lives that it's impossible to number them. When I say that it's been thousands of men and women that have been touched by that ministry, touched by outreach, that's God's heart. Getting out on the streets and touching and witnessing to those who are unsaved. Because whether you know it or not, there are people who are unsaved. Unsaved in your family. Unsaved on the streets. Unsaved on our jobs. We're not done. We need to get out here and be witnesses of Jesus Christ. But you can't be a witness unless you have power. And you can't get power unless you have faith. Faith in God's word, and you're praying and asking God to give you that strength. See, whenever we're talking about fervently praying, we're not talking about some praying out of habit. I'm just going to get on my knees and make some type of lukewarm attempt to have God move on your behalf. God does not work by that. Some lifeless, half-hearted prayer that you're trying to get God to do something. I remember when I was a child. I'm going to tell this story real quick. My grandmother, I loved her to life. I remember I would go always in the summer. I would go stay with my grandmother in Arkansas. My mom and my dad would always send me there. I loved being with my grandmother. And I'll never forget one day I was praying and I thought that I was going forth. And I said, "Now lay me down to sleep. I pray the Lord my soul to keep. If I should die," and before I got the words out of my mouth, my grandmother thumped me on the back of the head and said, "What are you doing? That's not how you pray." And she began to teach me the Lord's Prayer. And to this day, my grandmother is the person who led me into the Lord's Prayer. When I close out every prayer at night, I close it out with the Lord's Prayer. Amen. Now, we can't come to God with some type of nonsense. We have to come to God and ask God to move on our behalf. God has to see that we're serious about prayer. You can't come to God with some half-hearted formality of prayer. You have to come to God with power and strength and move God's heart on your behalf. Move God's mind to your mind. Let him know, Lord, I'm praying and I'm interceding for your people. See, when you look at the book of Colossians 4 and 12. Colossians 4 and 12. I feel it up in here. Can I preach like I feel it? Is it all right? Y'all don't mind doing it. It says, Eberus, who is one of you, a servant of Christ, saluted you. This is Paul. He's talking about this particular man of God. He's saying, always laboring fervently for you in prayers, that ye may stand perfect and complete in the will of God. Y'all, you got to understand what Paul is saying. Out of all of the men of God in the book that Paul was ever associated with, this man right here, Paul, himself Paul, Timothy, and this brother were called bond servants. You don't see it anywhere in the Word of God besides these two people who Paul called them. Why? Because this brother labored fervently. I'm talking about this man of God was laboring not for himself, but he was laboring for the saints of God. And when you look at when they're talking about laboring, it said that he was laboring to the point that it heavily, it was laboring to toil to the extent that he was in pain. He just wasn't praying. He was praying to the point that it was painful. He was going for before God because, see, you have to understand that there was false doctrine and false teaching being preached and tried to be preached to God's people in Colossae. And so this man of God stood up in the gap. This man of God knew the dangers that he was in. And he stood up and he persevered on behalf of God's people. Now, he didn't pray fervently for himself. He prayed for God's people that they fall not into false doctrine. I think we're at the point now we got to be praying for people who are falling into false doctrine and false teaching. Paul told Timothy, he said, a time is going to come where people won't even endure sound doctrine. When you tell them the truth, they don't even want to listen to it. They said they won't endure it. They'll just give up. No, I'm going to go find me another pastor. I'm going to go find me a church that fits the sinful lifestyle that I want to live. When you got a pastor preaching the truth, when you get a man or woman of God telling the truth, the first thing that a person wants to do is they want to run away. But this man labored fervently. He labored for the saints of God, that they be not deceived by the things of the world. They be not deceived by the false doctrine and the falsehoods that the enemy was pushing. But see, we got to persevere. We got to persevere. That's what my title was, to persevere. See, when we talk about persevere, in Ephesians 6 and 18, that word persevere, it only occurs one other time in the Bible. And it only occurs one time in the Bible. And that is in Ephesians 6 and 18. It is described in so many other ways, though. When you say perseverance, perseverance only comes up one time, and I was studying God's word, and I said, Lord, a word that is as strong as perseverance, why did it not show up any other time? what it showed up because it has other meanings. But in its simplest forms, it means persistent in prayer. It's so much more than that, though. It's an attitude. It's a patient endurance. It's steadfastness. It's persistent under harsh conditions. It's not backing up and not give. Can I preach like I feel it? Is that, if that all right out there, y'all? Can I just go forth if you don't mind? See, it's going forth no matter what the enemy is doing. It's going forth no matter what people are doing. God, I pray. It doesn't matter who walks away. I got to trust in God. It doesn't matter what I'm going through. I got to pray. I got to push through. I got to persevere on behalf of my family. I got to persevere on behalf of the saints. I got to stand in the gap sometimes for my pastor. I got to stand in the gap for the first family, for my church family, for my mother and my sisters and my nephew and my in-laws and my son and my wife. I got to stand up for them. I got to persevere against every trick and device of the enemy. All of my friends that might be sick and going through, I got to stand because I told them, I'm praying for you. I'm believing God for you. I'm standing in the gap for you. I'm standing and believing God's promises for you. Amen. Praise the living God. See, perseverance and patience are often connected. See, patience is the act or power of calmly or contently waiting for something due or hoped for. See, everybody doesn't persevere. Everybody doesn't, it's just so easy to quit these days. It's so easy to go find you another pastor on TV. It's so easy to go find you another church TV. People will tell you, amen, well, you know, my pastor, he's on TV. He's that's my pastor. You know, I met him on TV. Man, you got to be in church. You got to be in prayer and asking God, who do I need to follow? Who is the person that needs to lead me? You just can't be following anybody these days. See, the deal is now we're so off into politics and political issues and social issues. We need to be preaching and teaching and talking about saving souls and witnessing and delivering and setting people free from bondage. Because whether or not you know it, there are still people that are bound. Whether or not you know it or not, there are still people that are going through. There are people that are still struggling with drugs and alcohol. See, now they make marijuana easy to get. Anybody who has driving down the street and just start smoking marijuana, and they said everything is okay for anxiety. See, the devil is a liar. You better make sure that you're doing the things of God, that you're persevering against the world and the things that the world will throw at you. See, perseverance in prayer is rare, and it's a difficult attainment because everybody doesn't want to pray. People feel that I'm going to give God this little 5 or 6 minute prayer. God doesn't operate like that. You got to get on your knees and on your face, and you got to beg God to show up. You got to show God that it's serious, that you are serious about what you're praying for. You got to ask God and tell him, Lord, I'm serious about the situations that I'm dealing with. Father, I'm serious about souls being saved. Father, I'm serious about being an intercessor. Father, I'm serious about my family. Lord God, in the name of Jesus, Lord God, protect my family. Family God. Lord God, strengthen and shield them in the name of Jesus Christ. My God, we're living in perilous times. How can we not be praying? How can we not be going forth in God? We're standing on the sidelines playing games. We got to get serious about prayer. See, it's a manifestation of unbelief that when our first prayers are not successful, we immediately throw away the towel. We just give up hope and our passion because God did not answer. No, no. See, perseverance is something totally different. Perseverance in faith. Perseverance in your belief in prayer. You have to persevere to not fall from the faith. Don't you know that people who've been saved all of their lives are walking away from the church of the living God and could care less? They're going to believe things that you never thought that they would ever believe. believe. I'm not talking about persevering in prayer. I'm talking about even persevering in faith. People just give up. They just don't even care. My God, don't you know that God can come at any time? Don't you know that when you walk outside, you don't know if that's your last moment or that's your last hour, that's your last second. You got to persevere not only in faith and trust in God. You got to persevere in faith. You got to persevere in trust. You got to persevere and believe that God is going to give you the strength to be able to hang on in there. You got to cling to it. You got to hold fast and be devoted to faith. You got to hold fast and be devoted to God's word. You got to hold fast and be devoted to prayer, to standing in the gap. See, being persistent in prayer, it brings a transforming element into our lives. See, it builds character and helps us to develop into the very characteristics of God. See, just because it's delayed does not mean that God needs to change, but God is trying to change us. He's trying to teach us a lesson. He's trying to show us to be consistent. He's trying to show us to stand. He's trying to show us that you got to believe. You got to persevere. You got to trust in me. Can I preach like I feel it? Y'all don't mind, do you? I feel God in this place. You got to trust in God with all that you have in order to persevere. I'm about to close. I know I've gone over a whole lot, but you got to persevere, saints of God. Brothers and sisters, now is not the time to get weary. Now is not the time to get faint. Now is not the time to be tossed about with the winds of false doctrine, social media, and all the nonsense that it brings, all of these political views that don't make any sense at all. That's why I thank God for discernment, that I can see right through an individual or a person bringing some nonsense to me. But I thank God most of all that he's given me the gospel of Jesus Christ. See, I'm not ashamed of the gospel of Jesus Christ, because it's the power of God unto salvation to everyone that believes. See, you got to believe in this gospel. If you believe, God won't let you go astray. He'll help you to be persistent. He'll give you the perseverance that you need to be able to make it. He'll give you the endurance, the strength, the steadfastness that you need to be able to stand and to believe and trust solely in God. Oh God, I bless you today, God. In 1 Thessalonians 5 and 17, and I'm almost done. 1 Thessalonians 5 and 17. It says, pray without ceasing. Pray without ceasing. That's all that it says. We are to pray continuously. Prayer is just a constant communication with God. It's shutting out the distractions that come your way. I'll never forget, and I'm going to close. I used to be the armor bearer to a pastor, and I used to have to go pick up the ministry gift, the bishops and all of these men and women of God. And I'll never forget, I picked up a bishop, when I picked him up and he got in the vehicle, you know, he spoke and everything. And the whole time that we were driving in the vehicle from the airport, he was just praying. He just never stopped praying. And before we got to his hotel, he said, hey, take me over there to get some clothes. I want to get me a new suit. So I took him over to the mall, and when he got back in the car, he was praying. When I picked him up from service, he was praying. When I dropped him off, he was praying. It left an impression on me about a communication with God. Because see, you don't know when. That's why it says be instant in prayer. You don't know when someone might call upon you to pray. David said, and I'm closing with this scripture, in Psalm 55 and 16 and 17. He said, as for me, I will call upon God, and the Lord shall save me. Evening and morning and noon, I will pray and cry aloud, and he shall hear my voice. he shall hear my voice. Let me encourage you, brothers and sisters. Prayer is morning, noon, evening. It's time to pray. We have to stand in the gap. We have to let God know that we're serious about prayer. Perseverance in prayer, persistency, standing and believing. That widow went to that judge over and over, so much so that it vexed her. That man's like, okay, let me just go ahead and give that to you. What more would our righteous judge, our Lord and our Savior, give to us if we are persistent in prayer? And I'm not talking about 5 or 10. You got to be persistent in prayer. Don't let anything stop you from going and getting before God. Let's pray. Father, in the name of our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. My God, we bless you. We praise you. We thank you. God, we honor you. You just our God. You are our deliverer and our strength. Father, I pray even now, dear God, that someone says, Brother Cedric, I need to pray more. Brother Cedric, I need to seek God's face more. I pray that your people are encouraged and strengthened by this word. Lord, we bless you and praise you. We thank you for who you are in our lives, all that you continue to do. Encourage your people to persevere, to be persistent in prayer. In Jesus' name, amen. Give me what to say.
Let me hear you. Thank you for listening. If this teaching has been a blessing to you and you'd like to partner with our ministry to share the message of Jesus Christ, please visit our website at www.hmclive.org and click the donate button. If you're in our area, we invite you to join us at 4317 Lippincott Boulevard, Burton, Michigan, 48519. Harris Memorial Church of God in Christ, teaching the truth and showing the love. Use me, Lord.